All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Valley Creek Church. I am so glad that you are here with us today. And we want to give a big welcome to all our campuses, whether you're in Denton Venue, the Flower Mound, online, wherever you are watching in the world. We are so glad that you are here with us today. And if you missed last week with us, we kicked off the year and I shared with you that 2017, our theme for the year is healthy relationships. And so if you weren't here, I really want to encourage you, make sure you get one of these cards. It's got all the information on it, some things we're going to walk through together for the year, because I'm believing that there is a divine favor, a divine grace for the area of healthy relationships this year if we will choose to lean into it together. And so if you weren't here, get that card. Make sure you watch the message online, because it really sets the tone or the theme for the year, because what we're going to do today is kick off a new series called With. And for the next few weeks, we're going to talk about the presence of God, because you were never meant to be alone. And we're going to start our 21 days of prayer and fasting. And I want to invite you to do this with us. For the next 21 days, I want you to pray and fast with us. And you say, well, what is that? I've never done that before. Prayer is simply a conversation with God, and fasting is giving some stuff up so you can focus in on Him. That's all it is. Prayer is a conversation between you and God. Fasting is creating some space in your life so you can focus on God. Fasting disconnects you from the world. Prayer connects you to God. And at the end of the day, we can't make God move, but we can always create space for Him to fill. And so my encouragement to you would be, over the next 21 days, just think of something you can fast, something you can give up. Maybe it's a meal a day, or social media, or TV, a hobby, some entertainment, some things that occupy your time or your energy. Give those things up to create a hunger or desperation in your heart for God, and then spend that time talking to Him. Ask Him questions, invite Him to speak to you, process your heart with Him, and watch what He will do. And so when you came in, you should have got one of these prayer and fasting guides. And what I'd encourage you to do right now is, if you have a phone and you've not ever done this with us before, text VCC Fast to 41411. VCC Fast to 41411. And what will happen is, for over the next 21 days, every day we'll send you one simple text message to remind you and encourage you that we're on this journey together, that thousands of other people are creating space in their life for God to move. And it's also a great way that we're able to communicate with you about a lot of the things that are happening in a big picture sense around here. But here's what I've learned over the last couple of years, because we've done this every year for the last couple of years. I think sometimes we get so focused on what we're giving up that we forget about what we're supposed to be adding in. I think sometimes when we pray and fast, it becomes all about the fasting and what it is that we're giving up. And we get so focused on what we're letting go that we forget to add things into our lives. And so this year, I want to challenge you. Let's be more focused on what we're adding in instead of what we're giving up. And if you'll look at this thing with me, there's basically three things that I want to invite you to add into your life over the next 21 days. Really simple, really small next step. First thing is this: I just want to encourage you to read the Bible every single day for the next 21 days. One chapter a day. We got it all listed out there for you. You don't even have to think about where you go. You just open that thing up. You look at the date, one chapter, a few minutes a day, and watch what God will do. Because this is the wisdom and the word of God. Jesus says, man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Just like you can't survive without eating every single day, your soul can't survive without feeding it on the word of God. God writes like He speaks. And so if you want to know what the voice of God sounds like, start reading His word, and you'll learn to listen to His voice, and He has some great things to say to you. One chapter a day, it's all laid out there for you. I promise you can do it. Second thing I want to encourage you to add into your life is, there's five verses there that I want to challenge you to memorize and meditate. Five simple verses. They're pretty simple and short and concise, that you can memorize and meditate. Put them in your mind, put them in your heart, and churn on them. Because here's the deal. We don't work on the scriptures. The scriptures work on us. I don't have to work on the word of God. The word of God works on me. I just got to get it inside of me. Hebrews 4:12, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It's alive. And if I'll put it inside of me, it'll start to change me. In fact, Romans 12:2, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. In other words, change the way you think, and it'll change the way you live. But the only way you change the way you think is by starting to agree with what God has already said. So five verses that are in alignment with this series With and the presence of God. And then the last thing I want to challenge and encourage you to add into your life is over these next 21 days, take one next step on your journey with Jesus at Valley Creek Church. One simple next step on your journey with Jesus at Valley Creek Church, because we're a church that's all about helping people take their next step. Okay. And if you say, that's great, but I don't know what mine is, well, awesome. We've developed an awesome new little journey tool for you that you're going to be able to follow. And we hope every person in our church, no matter how long you've been here, at some point in time, you will go through this journey. We hope that along the way, you're going to accept Jesus as Lord and get water baptized. And then we hope you'll engage in our gatherings and not just show up, but participate with faith, hope, and love. We hope you'll then go to the Pathway classes, which happen every Sunday morning, that talk about who we are and what's happening and how you can be a part of what God's doing in this place. And then we hope you get in a group where you can meet some other people and create the best relationships of your life and move forward with Jesus. And then we want you to be a part of a serving team where you can use what God has put inside of you to make an impact into the world around you. And then we want you to find freedom, because free people get freer. And freedom is not a one-time event, it's a lifestyle. And so we want you to go to the freedom gathering that will set you free from all of the junk of this world that tries to pull your heart down. And then we hope you'll become a leader. Because we believe every person in this church is created to be a kingdom-minded leader in whatever sphere of society God has placed you in. And we've got a great new thing called Leader Step, a four-session experience to help you become that leader. Then we hope you'll live a life of next steps on mission with Jesus. Remember, at the end of the day, we're not trying to give you a nice church experience. We're trying to help you become like Jesus. And that's the best church experience you can have. Okay? And so I hope over these next 21 days, you'll think about adding those three things into your life. And the last thing is this: every day, if you do nothing else, here's what I want you to do. Every day for the next 21 days, pray this one prayer. Lord, help me be aware that you are with me. One prayer. Every day for the next 21 days, if you do nothing else. Lord, help me be aware that you are with me. It's one of the most important prayers that you can pray, because you are never created to be alone. Loneliness is a sorrow the human heart was never meant to experience. And yet, if we're honest, we're very lonely. Loneliness attacks all of us. You can be lonely in a crowd of people or in your bed late at night by yourself. You can be lonely on your drive to work or at a family gathering. You can be lonely when you have everything, and you can be lonely when you have nothing. You can be alone when you're all by yourself, or you can feel alone when you're surrounded by a group of people that you know. It doesn't matter who you are. Loneliness attacks us all. And if I'm really honest with you, I've struggled with loneliness throughout my entire life. As far back as I can look, I can remember being lonely. And the interesting thing about me and my loneliness is I often feel more lonely when I'm around people than when I do when I'm by myself. In fact, there's two moments in my life that I can remember probably feeling the most alone. I remember when I was a sophomore in college, I played college lacrosse. And if you know anything about me, I'm kind of an all or nothing kind of guy. Like, I'm all in or I'm all out, but I don't ride the middle of the road, okay? So I'm playing college lacrosse, so I'm all in. I mean, this is why I'm in school. This is what I'm doing. So I eat right. I work out. I'm healthy. I go to bed early. I wake up early in the morning. We practice. We train. This is going to be our year. And my sophomore year was like, this is the year. We're going to win the national championship. We can do it. And so we work hard all year. We get all the way to the end. We get to the national championship game. Can't believe we're actually playing in it. We're in the game. It's an amazing game. We're up by a couple goals. And all of a sudden, it's just about over. The ref blows the whistle. We win the game. And it's one of those moments you see where everybody starts throwing their gear, gloves and sticks and helmets flying all over the field because we won. And my team, we all come running together. And somehow I ended up on the bottom of the pile. Do you know those piles? Okay, just so you know, you cannot breathe on the bottom of the pile. If you're ever in one of those, be on the top, not on the bottom. And so my whole team is on top of me. We just won the national championship. Everything I've just spent the last few years chasing, and I'm on the bottom of this pile, not 5 minutes after we have just won, and I felt so incredibly alone. An ache in my soul, like, is this really all that it's about? And then the second time that I probably felt the most lonely was when we opened the Flower Mound Worship Center. For a few years, we had been planning and praying and casting a vision. We gave generously. We pursued God. We sought this impossible vision. And on the weekend, we opened the Flower Mound Worship Center. It was packed and thousands of people are here. And it's this move of God. Everyone's taking pictures and high-fiving and celebrating and cheering. And I remember in the midst of all of this crowd of people sitting on the edge of the platform and feeling totally alone. And I bet you can tell your own stories of loneliness too. And I bet if you look back through your life, you can see the patterns of where it comes over and over again. But the paradox is this: you were never created to be alone. In fact, when God made Adam and Eve, he put them in the Garden of Eden that they might be with him. He created them to live in his presence. Genesis 1:28, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. God says to Adam and Eve, hey, like, I've created you to be with me. You're my delegated authority on this earth. You're going to rule and reign with me. We're going to do this together. It's going to be amazing. I'm going to be your loving father. You'll be my loved children. We're going to walk together. It even says God walked with them in the garden in the cool of the day. They were made by love. They were birthed in love to live a life of love by a God of love, to enjoy his presence. In fact, Psalm 16:11 says, in his presence is fullness of joy. The human heart is most alive in the presence of God. And his presence was always meant to be the centerpiece of our life. But the moment Adam and Eve sinned and they took that forbidden fruit, they were separated from God. Sin, shame, fear, nakedness entered into the world and they ran and they hid. And for the first time, the ache of loneliness penetrated the human heart. And loneliness has always caused us to make bad choices. The loneliness caused Adam and Eve to run and hide and build fig leaves and live a life of self-righteousness. Noah, when he gets off the boat after the world has been flooded, he's lonely when he realizes he's one of only eight people on the entire earth. And it says he gets drunk, passes out naked in his tent, and his kids find him. Let's just agree, that wasn't a good moment for Noah. David, when he's lonely, he's on his palace late at night, and he's so lonely that he sees Bathsheba, another man's wife, goes, gets her, sleeps with her, she gets pregnant, ultimately has her husband killed. Elijah, he is so alone, he feels like he's the only person that's walking with God that he literally asks God to take his life. Loneliness makes us make bad choices. And I wonder what kind of choices it makes you make. I think we try to numb our loneliness with things that only increase it, like pornography and substances and social media and workaholism and codependent relationships. It's fascinating how the things of the world only become like gasoline on the fire and increase that sense of loneliness within our hearts. And the paradox is this, you think like the reason you can feel alone when you're surrounded by people is because you will never feel connected to others until you first know you're connected to God. You will never feel found by other people until you'll first know that you are found by God. Because you see, the truth is, at the end of the day, we're all playing a game of hide and seek with God. And inherently, you and I know that. Like we know we're playing hide and seek with God. Only we think he's hiding and we're the ones who are seeking. That he's this mysterious God somewhere way off in the cosmos. And if we just do everything just right and put it all together, maybe if we try really hard, we can catch a fleeting glimpse of God sometime in our life. And we strive and we struggle. But what we forget is that we're the ones who are hiding and he is the one that is seeking. The moment Adam and Eve sin, they run and they and thus began the first game of hide and seek in all of human history. And it says God comes walking through the garden. Adam, where are you? Or how about Moses? Moses kills a man in anger, an Egyptian soldier, and he runs out into the desert and he spends his life hiding out as a shepherd. And God comes walking through Moses' life through the burning bush. Moses, where are you? Or when David takes Bathsheba and has her husband Uriah killed, he's hiding out in his palace and God comes to find him walking through his life as the prophet Nathan. David, where are you? How about you? Where are you hiding? God is walking through your life saying, where are you? Come out, wherever you are. We're really bad at hiding and he's really good at seeking and he never loses. The truth is that God wants to be with us more than we want to be with him. And so what I'm trying to tell you is you don't have to seek God's presence because God's presence is seeking you. Now, if you got your Bible, Genesis chapter 28. Genesis chapter 28, this is the story of Jacob. And if you know anything about Jacob, Jacob's not a great dude, okay? He's really not a good guy. Jacob is a deceiver. He's a manipulator. He's a liar. He's a thief. He's cheated his twin brother Esau out of his birthright. And then because Jacob is the second born, he really wants his firstborn brother's Esau's blessing. And so he goes to this great lengths because his father is old and blind. And it says Esau is a hairy man and Jacob is a smooth man. So Jacob goes and kills some goats, takes raw goat skin, wraps them around on his arms so he can go into his father. So when his father touches his arms, it feels like they're hairy arms so that he could pretend that he's Esau so he can get the blessing. I'm just saying, you a deceptive dude and desperate if you're putting raw goat skin on your arms to get a blessing, okay? That's Jacob. And so Esau is furious, wants to kill him. So his mother is sending Jacob away to go find a wife to get out of there. So basically in Genesis 28, we find Jacob. He's running for his life looking for a wife. Some of you, maybe you've gone through that same experience, okay? Genesis 28, verse 10. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. When he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord, and he said, I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will be spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All the peoples on the earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, ready? Surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. He was afraid and said, how awesome in this place. This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven. Catch it. Here is Jacob, this sinful, lonely guy hiding out in the desert. And he's not only not interested in God, he's not even thinking about God, let alone seeking God. And one day, as he's going about his life all alone, God shows up and interrupts Jacob's life with his presence. God reveals himself to Jacob. And Jacob utters some of the most profound words ever. Surely God is in this place, and I was not aware of it. And in that moment, he has an awakening. He has an awakening to the presence of God, an awakening that he has never been alone, or an awakening that God is with him, and everything changes. And I read that story to you because the truth is, that's the story of our lives. We're like Jacob. Broken people with messed up pasts, not sure really what we're doing. We're going through our life, doing our own thing. We wake up, we go to school, we go to work, we do our family, our commitments, our activities. We even come to church. And yet in the midst of all of that, God is showing up and interrupting our lives with his presence, trying to just get our attention. I mean, it's just like my kids. When I'm not paying attention to them, they'll start doing all kinds of crazy things to get my attention. They'll put underwear on their head, you know, and run through the room. They'll start doing crazy dances. They'll start throwing things at me like, Dad, pay attention to us. Notice us. It's what God does to you. Surely, God is in your marriage and you are not aware of it. Surely, God has been in your job and you've just not been aware of it. Surely, God has been in your circumstances, your pain, your loneliness in this church and you are not aware of it. And what we learn from Jacob is that God is with us, not because we are good, but because he is good. You see, the question at the end of the day, it's not, is God with me? It's, am I aware of his presence? That's the question. And the truth is, very few of us know a lot about God's presence. Even as I tee it up to you, I can just sense there's like a trepidation. We don't really know what to do with God's presence. No one's ever taught us about it. We're not sure if we've ever experienced it. All we know is those weird charismatic people somewhere at some point, they do weird things sometimes when they say God shows up, right? I mean, that's what we know. And it's easy to say like, hey, and we're one of those weird charismatic people, by the way, if that stresses you out. But we don't do the weird part. That's the cool part. Life-giving, spirit-filled, Jesus-focused. Ba-da, shh. Okay. And it's easy to say God is with me, like right out of this intellectual knowledge. But listen to me, God's presence is not information to know. He's a person to experience, and his name is Jesus. And so what I would say to you is that God's presence, here's a simple definition. God's presence is that we are aware that he is with us and that he is revealing himself to us. It's all it is. He said, we're aware that he is with us and revealing himself to us. And there's multiple ways we need to be awakened, like Jacob, to his presence in our life. Really simple for you. First one is this: his presence holds you together. Colossians 1:17 says, in him all things hold together. The presence of God is literally holding the fiber and the fabric of this universe together. The presence of God is holding the very DNA, the molecules, the cells, the atoms, the nerves of your body in this moment. God's presence is literally holding the physical construct of your body together, so much to the point that he's holding the very molecules of the chair you're sitting on with his presence, that if his presence was removed, the chair would fly apart and you would fall to the ground. And so the question I would ask you is this, is that when your job, your marriage, or your circumstances seem to be flying apart, are you aware that he is literally holding you together? His presence holds you together. Second thing is his presence surrounds you. Psalm 139:7 says, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? God's presence literally surrounds you. It's above you, it's below you, it's in front of you, it's behind you, it's to the left and to the right of you. Wherever you go, there he is. There is nowhere you can go, there is nowhere you can run, there is nowhere you can hide. You are no longer lost because he says you are now found. You are no longer alone because he says he is now with you. So when you walk through this life, are you aware that God's presence is literally going before you? The third area is that God's presence is literally within us. John 20:22, Jesus breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. The moment you put your faith or your trust in Jesus, the Spirit of the living God comes and dwells inside of you. That's how you arise to new life in Jesus. The same Spirit that had the power to raise Jesus from the grave is now alive and well within you and upon you. The Spirit of the living God lives in you. 1 Corinthians 6 says, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You are bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. God does not live in temples or buildings made by human hands. He dwells in you. In fact, if you can catch this, God does not live in heaven. Heaven lives in God. God does not live in heaven. Heaven lives in God. You say, what does that mean? Well, Genesis 1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God is not in heaven. Heaven is in God. You say, then where does God live? In you. You're the temple of the Holy Spirit. Galatians 2:20, I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live. It's Christ who lives within me. So when you walk through life, are you aware when you need power and you need guidance and you need counsel, are you aware that he is literally dwelling or taking up residence inside of you? The fourth area of his presence that we're invited to experience is that his presence is in our godly relationships. Matthew 18:20, where two or three are gathered, there I am also. In other words, Jesus says, when you show up and meet with other believers, he himself comes in a unique measure to show up in that place. That when you get in your small groups, your serve teams, people you pray with, people that are walking with Jesus, and you get together to gather around the name of Jesus, Jesus himself says he shows up with a unique measure of his presence to reveal himself to you. That's why you need groups, and you need serve teams, and you need godly relationships, because without them, you will miss out on this facet of the presence of God that is available to you. In fact, some of the greatest encounters I've ever had with the presence of God has come in small group settings. Just this week, I was in a meeting with some of our team, like 10 people, and we were sitting there. And man, God just showed up. Why? Because where two or three are gathered, he shows up. So when you're in those godly relationships, are you aware that Jesus himself has pulled up a chair and he is there to bring you the counsel, the compassion, and the hope that you need? And then the fifth way is God, his presence is literally tangible in our worship. Psalm says that God inhabits the praises of his people. He is enthroned on the praises of Israel, another translation says, which basically means God goes where he's wanted. When you and I choose to worship him, it says we literally enthrone him on our praises, which means this. When you sing like we just did, and you raise your voice, and you raise your hands, you raise your faith, you raise your heart, what your worship is doing is it's literally gathering with everyone else's in this room, and it is making a throne in the spiritual realm, in the center of this room. And as your praise creates a throne for Jesus himself, he says he comes, and he sits on that throne. And when he shows up, the kingdom of God comes with him. He comes to rule and reign. Wherever the life of God comes to rule, his life will follow and he will reign. And he shows up to bring his hope and his life and his love to your circumstances, your fear, your brokenness, your pain, and your anxiety. It is so much more than singing a few songs. So when we worship, are you aware that you are literally being transported into the throne room of heaven? Surely God is in this place. And I was not aware of it. The question is not, is God with me? The question is am I aware of his presence? And that's our problem. We're unaware. We are so focused on everything that is happening in front of us that we miss God all around us. Like, I don't know about you, but I'm a pretty aloof person. Anyone else want to agree with that? Like, I will go to a party with my wife, and we will walk in, and within 30 seconds of walking in the room, she's figured out everything that's happening in the room. She literally like can spot everybody. Oh, this person over here, they're lonely. And this person over here, they're struggling. And this couple over here, they're fighting. You know, that's not very good over there. And this person, something great's happening in their life. So I want to celebrate with them. And we'll get back in the car after, and the first 5 minutes, she'll be like, you see, this was happening with this person. These people, this was going on. And then she'll ask me, so what did you notice? And I say, the chips were good. It's about all I got. You know, in fact, we have this like running joke in our home of how like unaware I am, like whatever I'm doing, I'm so engrossed in it that she can literally walk into the room and be standing like 3 feet away from me, and I will be totally unaware that she's even there. And so she'll time it sometimes, like on her phone or on her clock, you know, and she'll just be standing there. I remember one time I read 5 chapters of a book I was in before I realized she was in the room with me. And when I looked up, she was like staring at me, you know, like, how long you been here? A long time, you know? Okay. I think that's a great picture of our life. We are so focused on what's happening in front of us. The pain, the anxiety, the fear, the doubt, the worry, the brokenness, the relational chaos, the things that we're struggling with in our, we're so focused on what's happening in front of us that we miss God all around us. Self-consciousness is the enemy of God awareness. Self-consciousness is the enemy of God awareness. The more I focus on myself, the less aware of him I will be. And you can see it through the Bible. You remember the story of the road to Emmaus? Here's a couple of disciples. Jesus has just been crucified. He's dead, he's buried, he's gone, and they think it's over, and they're so like heartbroken. It says they're walking on the road to Emmaus, and they're so down, they're so focused on their circumstances, their disappointment. It says the resurrected Jesus shows up and starts walking with them. And they don't realize it's Jesus. 7 miles, people. 7 miles they walk with the resurrected Jesus. But they are so focused on their own stuff that they miss God right next to them. Or how about Peter in John 21? He's denied Jesus to a servant girl. Jesus is dead and gone. He feels hopeless. So he goes fishing, and he's sitting in a fishing boat, and he's so focused on his own, self-condemnation that the resurrected Jesus shows up, comes walking down the shore, starts talking to them, but he doesn't even realize it's Jesus because he's so focused on his own failure that it's not until someone else points it out and says, it's the Lord. Or how about the Israelites? They're on their way from Egypt to the promised land. Pillar of cloud by day, pillar of fire by night. They are so self-conscious of their hunger, their thirst, and their fear that they literally miss a ball of flame flying over them 24 hours a day. How about you? What are you so focused on that you miss him all around you? I am convinced that the Holy Spirit is the most ignored person in church. You go to any church on a Sunday morning and you say, there's a lot of lonely people that show up. Yeah, and there's a Holy Spirit who is ignored more than any of them. And our unawareness of his presence has cost us dearly. It leaves you with fear and insecurity and sickness and hopelessness and loneliness. My prayer for our church is that we would get to a place where we are so hungry and desperate to be aware of the presence of God, that we would be a presence-based people and a presence-based church. 2 Corinthians 4:18 says, so we fix our eyes not on what is seen. Who cares about what's right in front of you, but what is unseen? For what is seen, this is temporary. It's here today, it's gone tomorrow. But what is unseen, his presence all around us, that's eternal and that's what matters. So we need to change our perspective. We need to change our focus. Faith is the belief that God is with me even when I can't feel him. And I don't know about you, but I would rather be more aware of the God that's with me than the world that's against me. And the choice will always be yours. You see, what I think is so cool about the story of Jacob is I love this little thing that he has in his dream. It says he sees a stairway to heaven and angels ascending and descending upon it. Okay, what is that a prophetic picture of? It's a prophetic picture of Jesus. Because Jesus is the gateway to heaven. In fact, in John 1, Jesus says, you will see the Son of Man and you will see angels ascending and descending upon him. I think we have that verse for you. John 1:51. Angels ascending and descending upon him and heaven be open. What is that? That's Jesus, the gateway to heaven, and what God has opened, no man can close. Isaiah 64, that you would rend the heavens and come down. And so what we're seeing in this picture with Jacob as he has this dream is this prophetic picture of Jesus, that when Jesus was to come, we would all now live under an open heaven. That Jesus would show up and literally open heaven, and all who believe in him live under that kind of open heaven. And you say, well, what is an open heaven? It's exactly what's here in Genesis 28. God's presence is always with you. You have the Father's voice of love. Your life will be filled with blessings. You have the authority to reach into heaven and bring it to earth. And God promises he will fulfill your destiny for you, that you don't have to do it by yourself. All you have to do is be aware. Genesis 28 is a prophetic picture of what Jesus was going to come to do for you and me. And the beauty is that what we gained in Jesus is more than what we lost in Adam. I mean, listen to this. Romans 5 says this, for if by the trespass of one man, Adam, death or loneliness reigned through that one man, how much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and the gift of righteousness reign in life or experience God's presence through the one man, Jesus Christ? Literally says, this is what we had in Adam. God put us in the Garden of Eden and we walked with God in the cool of the day. But when Adam sinned, boom, we lost it all and we became lonely. But then Jesus showed up. And if this is what we had in Adam, when Jesus showed up, boom, this is what we now have in Jesus. This is what we had in Adam, walking with God in the cool of the day. Adam lost it. We became lonely. Jesus showed up and said, guess what? I'm going to give you even more than walking with God in the cool of the day. I'm going to give you God walking in the garden of your heart. We say, I would rather walk with God in the Garden of Eden. I would rather have God live in the garden of my heart. What you gained in Jesus is more than what you lost in Adam. And when you become aware of this, everything changes. Listen, let me close it with this. Look at this. Verse 18, early the next morning, Jacob took the stone he had placed under his head and set it up as a pillar, and he poured oil on top of it. He called that place Bethel, though the city used to be called Luz. Then Jacob made a vow saying, if God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I am taking and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear so that I return safely to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God, and the stone I have set up as a pillar will be God's house, and of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth. Do you understand the dramatic transformation that happens in one moment in time? This is Jacob, the lying, deceiving, selfish thief. And he has one moment of becoming aware that God was with him. And he becomes humble, and he worships, and he becomes generous. It literally says he worships. He pours himself out on this worship experience to God, and it says he chooses to start tithing. He starts giving. Okay, wait a second. How on earth do you go from being selfish to worshiping? From being greedy to being generous? You become aware that God is with you, and everything in your life changes. God then becomes proud to be known as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, because there's such a transformation, and Jesus comes from his lineage. The presence of God is the greatest change agent on the face of the earth. 2 Corinthians 3:17, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. When you become aware he is with you, you find freedom from every bondage that you carry in your life. Because when he is here, all of the love and the power and the wisdom and the healing of heaven and the kingdom of God is also here. And so you're a stay-at-home parent and you think you can't do it one more day? If God is with you, then you already have all the patience you will ever need. If you're a business person and you don't think you have what it takes, if God is with you, then you already have all the wisdom you will ever need. If you're single and you feel alone, if God is with you, then you already have more companionship and love than you will ever need. If you're a student and you're not sure what your place is in this world, if God is with you, you already have more significance than you will ever need. And if you're overwhelmed, if God is with you, then you already have all the peace you will ever need. Because if he is here, then so is everything else that we will ever need. Loneliness is simply your invitation to become aware that God is with you. Surely God is in this place and I was not aware of it. You do not have to make God come. You just have to be aware he already is here. So will you close your eyes with me? And can I ask you to just take a deep breath for a moment? Surely, God is in this place, and we were not aware of it. And so, Holy Spirit, we invite you to interrupt our lives. We invite you to interrupt our lives with you. Would you give us the courage to take our eyes off the fear, the pain, the brokenness, the needs, the doubts, the worries, the anxiety, the stuff, the busyness? And help us lift up our gaze to what matters most. You are here. You are with us, not because we are good, but because you are good. Lord Jesus, I pray that as we walk through this week, we will pray that simple prayer. And as we become aware that you are with us, like Jacob, may we be transformed in your presence. Strip away all of the old and give us all of the new, not by striving and struggling, but by a moment of revelation that God lives in me, so all of the life of heaven can flow out of me. May we be a people who know you, who love you, and most importantly, who are aware of you. Make yourself known to us, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.